Seema Kumar at the Johnson & Johnson Collaboratory, and joining me here today is Dr. Arthur Horwitz, and he is the winner, one of the two winners of this year's the Paul Janssen Award for Biomedical Research. Welcome, Dr. Horwitz, and
thank you.
Congratulations.
Thank you. Pleasure to be here.
Yeah, and I'm going to call you Art
sure,
from now
please.
On.
Sure, please.
Yes. So, first of all, how does it feel?
Well, it's quite an honor. Receiving the word of this was really a thrill. That hasn't quite dampened, and I'm still really excited about it, and quite honored and much humbled. I knew about Dr. Paul's work for quite a while. When I was a medical student, we were certainly using a lot of the medicines that he founded during the 50s and 60s, and they're used even today. Mm-hmm. So he was really a giant. Mm-hmm. I think his ability to sort of conceptualize physiological problems and relate them to chemical compounds that would do good for them was remarkable. I mean, just amazing scientist.
It's wonderful. And thank you for the work you do, because, you know, one of our criteria is that the work that this award goes to is reflective of the spirit of Dr. Paul Janssen. So congratulations. So tell me a little bit about this work, protein folding. Why is that important?
Well, it's really a problem of information transfer. People are familiar with the idea that DNA encodes proteins and that there's a passage of information from DNA to messenger RNA to the translation of new proteins at ribosomes in our cells. A new protein is like a strand of spaghetti when it's leaving the ribosome. And it really is inactive as an enzyme or a structural element in the cell until it's properly folded into a three-dimensional characteristic architecture that it's biologically active form. So the story of protein folding really started in the late 50s, about the same time that mechanisms of protein synthesis were being worked out. There was a remarkable experiment that showed that if you unfolded an enzyme and asked whether it could find its way, starting with a completely unfolded strand of spaghetti, on its own, could it find its way back to a native folded state? And the answer turned out to be yes, and the workers on that experiment, Christian Anfinsen, received a Nobel Prize in the early 1970s for that work. It sort of begged the question of whether protein folding was a spontaneous event in cells, but people operated with the idea that, yes, this occurs in test tubes, so most likely it occurs spontaneously within cells. And we happen to be fortunate enough to be able to ask this question in a cell in the later part of the 1980s. So the experiment essentially was to ask whether proteins that enter the organelles that make energy, called the mitochondria, whether those proteins could be folded on the inside of the mitochondria spontaneously or whether a machine was needed. In particular, it was known that newly made mitochondrial proteins have to go through the mitochondrial membrane, sort of like an extended strand of spaghetti, in an unfolded state. And we were in a position to ask a question of whether on the other side of the membranes, when the protein had reached the inside, could it spontaneously refold to an active state, or did it need help from a machinery? And so we were screening a bank of yeast mutants, and indeed we found one where the proteins would go into mitochondria, but they were unable to fold to their native forms. And so that sparked the idea more generally that proteins inside cells need assistance to protein folding steps.
Mm-hmm. Yes, and so what happens when it goes awry, protein folding goes awry?
So there are several things that can happen to misfolded proteins. One is they tend to aggregate. So that means that the misfolded structures seem to find each other and make clumps. Often it's through what we call hydrophobic or water-hating surfaces. So these are sort of sticky surfaces that allow proteins to stick to each other. In a lot of neurodegenerative diseases, we see these kinds of clumps of protein aggregates, for example, Alzheimer's, Parkinson's, ALS, a number of the other neurodegenerative diseases, one sees aggregates. But another fate to misfolded proteins is that they can be proteolytically degraded. So they're just removed from the cell. Frequently, the degradation apparatus will be successful to remove a bad protein, but the aggregates are what seem to supervene in many cases where the system becomes overloaded.
And so when that happens, and for example, in Alzheimer's disease, there is probably an aspect of protein misfolding. We don't know yet sure exactly what causes Alzheimer's, but clearly the plaques in the brain have, you know.
It seems that at least a piece of the amyloid precursor protein called the A-beta peptide, and potentially as well a misfolded species of the protein that's called tau, are somehow involved with aggravating a process. So at this point, we don't entirely understand what's going on. This is a little away from my immediate work, but it's clear from published work that there isn't a complete understanding of what's going on.
Yeah. What's the importance of prizes like this, do you think?
Well, it's certainly wonderful for the receiving scientists. It's a real sort of shot in the arm that makes one feel that, you know, this is valuable and that there's some general forward progress being made. But I do think that one of the major purposes is to really inform the public of advances that are occurring in the areas of various areas of science. In this case, it would concern biological sciences, and try to relate those to where things might be going.
Did you know Dr. Paul Janssen?
I never got to meet him, but I certainly knew of his work.
Yeah. That's great. That's good. Well, congratulations once again.
Thank you so much.
On winning the Dr. Paul Janssen Award for Biomedical Research. And, you know, we look forward to celebrating with you both in New York City and in Beerse, Belgium, which is the home of Dr. Paul.
Likewise, I know Ulrich and I are quite excited about this.
Wonderful.